I wanted to say thank you to Jason and the organizing team for inviting me. My first time in Raleigh. Really cool city. Very glad to be here. Unlike the previous speaker, I'm going to talk a lot about data. I mentioned it quite a few times because I really like it. So let me just give you a brief intro to who I am and hopefully answer the burning question in your minds. Who are you and why am I listening to you? Because it's a very good question. Very good question. My name is Mark Head. I have been working with open data and doing civic hacking stuff probably since about 2008. I was working at various software companies in and around the Philadelphia area, in and around these companies were headquartered on the West Coast in various places. Came to learn about open data through a contest called Apps for Democracy, it was called. The District of Columbia ran an app contest in 2008, and I thought, wow, this is really interesting. Because I had done about 12 years combined in two different state governments. The last 4 or 5 of those years was working for the CIO of a state government. And I had left to pursue my passion and become a software developer. That's what I wanted to do. Or at least I thought that's what I wanted to do. I was really still very interested in government, still interested in knowing what was going on, finding ways to help. But there really weren't a lot of good options for me that I could relate to. And then this contest came along where I could build an app that was going to use government data and it was going to, hopefully impact the community. I thought I was instantly galvanized. This is what I wanted to do. So through various opportunities, twists of fate, I ended up working at an organization called Code for America. I was not an original employee, but I came in shortly after we got started. And then working there quite happily, I had been sort of agitating in the Philadelphia area for more open data and for them to create an open data portal. And then I got a call from the city CIO. He said, would you be interested in, I know you've been talking about this a lot, would you be interested in actually coming and doing it? And I told him no. I didn't want to go back to working in government, but I came to realize that this was a really good opportunity and that the mayor and the CIO of that city were committed to this, so I did it, and very happily. I've since left and I work for a company called Accela. My job is to work with cities all over the country and even around the world. I was in Australia last fall talking about this. So I get to work with cities everywhere to help them release open data. And what I really want to talk about, doing what I do, I get asked a lot, what is the future of civic technology? What's the future of open data? What's the future of civic hacking? And like a lot of people in that position, I've probably expounded at length about what I think the future looks like. But I've come to realize over time that I really don't know what the future holds. I don't know what the future of civic technology and open data look like. And I want to explore that a little bit. And if you saw the later talk I gave last night, this intro will make sense to you. But this is an important time. This is an important year, 2015. This is a really, really big year. Because this is the year where we get our hoverboards, right? This is the year. October 21st, 2015 was the year that Doc and Marty went to when they jumped into that souped-up DeLorean and went into the future. And this is what it's like, right? This is totally 2015. Actually, I think the only thing that's got right, if you look in the upper left, there's actually a throwback cafe to the 80s. The 80s actually did come back. I think they've since moved on again. So this is really the only thing that this prediction of the future got right. Here's another one. Anybody know what movie this is? 2001, Space Odyssey, from the genius mind of Stanley Kubrick. And this character's name is HAL 9000. HAL was the computer on the ill-fated ship. And if you remember this movie, and its less than successful follow-up, I guess, 2010 was that? I don't know. The Roy Scheider one, what?
They were books first.
That's very true. But with this sort of, this view of the future, this view is actually now in our past. That in the year 2001, we would be able to have conversations with computers. We would be able to talk to them using regular language And they would understand it well enough to pick up on nuance and subtlety and, you know, all of these other little bits of language that we all take for granted. Now, if any of you have called your bank or an airline or an insurance company, you know that we are unable to have regular conversations with computers. And I should point out that's not for lack of trying. I worked for a number of years in the telephony industry, working on speech recognition, working with speech recognition tools. I can tell you we are nowhere close, nowhere, after spending decades and billions probably trying to figure this out. Language is just so complex. Human language is just so complex. We're nowhere near this, and it is not for lack of trying. So this vision of the future, completely wrong, just totally and completely wrong. Let's look at another one, one of my favorites. Snake Blitzen. Remember Snake from the Escape from New York movie? So this is even closer to the date of prediction. So this was a movie that was made in the early 80s and it was predicting 1997. What would New York City look like in 1997? And the thought at the time was New York City would be so bad that it would no longer be inhabited by normal citizens. It would simply be a walled prison camp, basically. And the president in this movie had the bad fortune to actually crash land inside, and they had to send Snake in to go get it. So these are all, you know, interesting visions of the future. What I find particularly interesting is that at the time, they were somewhat plausible. We kind of believed, yeah, that sort of makes sense that we'll be, you know, surfing around on hoverboards and talking to computers and avoiding big cities. But the other unifying characteristic of all these things is they were all wrong. Every one of these predictions of what the future was going to look like was all wrong. So I'm always cautious in talking about what the future looks like. And I would submit to all of you to be especially careful in investing faith in people that peddle in prediction, because we're just not that good at it. We're not good at making it, and we're not good at actually seeing what happens. This is important for me for a lot of reasons. So one of them is the first job I got in government, first government job I got was in the time when the internet was really starting to take off. And it was not widely used in government. In fact, the office I worked in got its first email account while I was there. We only had one email address in the entire office, and I was the only one that knew how to use it. So you told government officials then, this is the early to mid-90s, that in a decade, in just a decade, the internet and technology would become so central to government service delivery that it would be essentially indispensable. They wouldn't believe you. They wouldn't have bought it. They would say, that's nonsense. I don't believe that at all. So we need to be very careful about it. The future and how we predict it and how we consume provisions of it. So I want to talk about the past. I want to talk about the present. And in doing those things, I hope it gives us some sense of where we might be going. But I want to stay away from any bold predictions if I can. I don't think in the civic technology, open data, civic hacking community, I don't think we talk enough about the past and where we come from. We're all swept up in this, and I think many of us have this preconceived notion that it's new. And the things that we are doing are things that have not been done before. And I want to touch on that. But first, let's talk, if we can, about civic hacking. So before we start this, who here is a coder, writes code, software developer? Okay. Who here thinks you need to be one of those to participate in a civic hacking event? Okay. This is distilled to its essence. Could you press that one time? This distilled to its essence is civic hacking. So this is a video that was taken in the UK, somewhere in the middle of the UK, north of London, south of Leeds. And this store over here is, I think they call this a takeaway in the UK. I have a security camera out there. And this is a bunch of people after a long night out. This is late into the evening. You would expect to see some shenanigans taking place here, but we don't see that. We have some folks here who've seen a bike rack. It's broken. And they're collectively deciding to fix it. You can see that guy in the red shirt, the big fella. He's into this. He's really leaning into it. So they're working together. We don't even know if these people actually even know each other. They may not even know each other. They've just been bystanders. But they're working together to fix what they perceive to be a problem. Now this guy can go, here comes the guy, the captain. He's going to set his food down here really. Hold this for me. I'm going to put my back into this here. Right? So it's. They're really, really leaning into this. Even a little guy there on the left says, I can help out here. And there you go. There you have it. Now they've fixed this bike rack. So when I explain to people that don't know anything about technology, that don't code, that don't practice in that business, what is civic hacking? I say this example is what civic hacking is. It's the awareness of some condition that is suboptimal in a place, typically a place that's close to you. And your awareness, your own awareness or perception of your ability to make a change on that. That's it. That is the essence of civic hacking right there. You perceive a problem, and you perceive your own ability to affect a change on that problem. That is it. The acts and the technology are incidental. They do not matter. They are a means to an end. Without the first two things, perceiving the problem and perceiving your own ability to affect a change on that problem, none of the technology matters. So that's what civic hacking is. We also have this conception that civic hacking is a new thing. It's something we just started. And I apologize for all these words, but I was doing research. Who's heard of the term build with, not for? It's become fairly popular lately. This idea that when we're building civic apps and building civic technology, we shouldn't just go and do it for communities that we need to serve, but we should do it with them. We make it to be inclusive. And this actually ties, it's a great idea, it actually ties quite closely to this idea that has a long history in the field of public administration called co-production. Anybody ever heard of co-production? So co-production is this idea that we'll collaboratively develop and refine public services. Think of community policing. So police officers are out walking the streets, communicating with the people that they're serving. And through that interaction, the people that are actually served have input into what that service looks like. You know, officer, we need you down here on this corner down here. There's some real troublemakers down there. And through that interaction, the service gets refined, it gets improved, it gets enhanced. So this, I was very surprised when I read this. I was doing some research on a piece I was writing about co-production. And I found this, and it is long, but I encourage you to read it. Because in my mind, this could be used almost word for word to describe the modern civic hacking movement. And it's from a journal called Public Administration Review, published in 1983, which I thought was really, really interesting. Let's think more broadly about civic hacking and what it is. Governments have a long, long history of working with volunteers to provide essential services. Now, I'll use the obvious example of volunteer firefighters. Anybody know what percentage of firefighters in this country are volunteers? Anybody want to take a guess? 39%? You said 80%? 90%? Good, it's 69%. So it's not quite that high, but it is the majority. The majority of firefighters in this country are volunteers. They don't get paid to fight fires and run into buildings that are burning, rescue people. This is an essential public service, but it isn't just volunteer firefighters, right? It's community watch groups. It's cleanup groups. When I was in the city of Philadelphia, this happened all the time. A group would come together and clean up a city park. Adopting a highway, organizations and businesses that adopt a highway. These are all important things that have been going on for many years, decades, and they're all in the same vein as civic hacking. All of these things honor the same tradition. So what is civic hacking? We're thinking about where we are and where we come from in civic hacking. The first thing I want to leave with you is that this is not a new thing. The exercise that we will undertake tomorrow part of a long and proud tradition in this country of volunteerism, of citizens and communities banding together to make the place where they live better. That is not a new thing, and that's okay. I think it's awesome that we are extending a tradition as proud and as important as that one. The other thing I want you to think about for a bit here is that all of this civic hacking, all of this open data, all of this stuff you're talking about, when you get down to it, it's built on top of a foundation of dissatisfaction. What do I mean by that? Doesn't feel very dissatisfying. So I'm gonna guess that you didn't expect to see these two words together on the same slide. I apologize for being a little bit cheeky, but the picture on the left, I got these both off of the internet, off of social media where I spent too much time. The picture on your left is the nicer one, but this is a sort of nice way of saying, wow, this pothole's been around. Long enough for me to grow flowers in, right? The one on the right is a little less so. This is a street artist that calls himself Wanksy. And his approach to calling attention to potholes is to draw penises around them, phallic symbols around them in spray paint. So both of these are now known far outside the places where they happen because of social media, because of the internet, because we live in an information age. And the lesson here for governments, if you're a government official or you work with a government, is that if you do not give people good feedback loops, if you do not give them the ability to give you feedback, and you feel like you're being responsive, then you're going to have penises, probably, or maybe spray painted on your streets. So this is a manifest example of dissatisfaction with public service. And it works today because of social media and the internet. So whether or not we give people the ability to provide input into the quality of services, they have tools now where they can express their dissatisfaction in a very visible way. Okay, this is another video. This is a little less intuitive, but what you're looking at right now is the actual video. Probably guess what it is. This is a web scraper. This is someone who is scraping data from the City of Philadelphia's website. The website has information on property tax balances, so people that have outstanding property tax bills. But it's only formatted for people's eyeballs. You only look at one record at a time. He wanted the whole thing, and the city wouldn't give it to him. He happens to be a very good computer programmer, so he wrote a program that scraped all of his data off the city's website. And because he was forced to do that by the city, he decided to make a video of it and post it on YouTube. And then he also posted the data. So the data ended up being released anyway. And a lesson here for government officials and for governments is that if you make data public, if you make it available for people's eyeballs, and you don't give them a reasonable way to get that data in bulk, they're going to come get it anyway. The tools are now available to do this. This is a very simple thing to do. It's not very pleasant. Most people that write webs, who here has written a web scraper before? I mean, you're me, you're going to Yeah, it's often not a pleasant experience. The code is never really very elegant. It's usually throwaway code. You write it and you keep it just long enough to scrape the data you want and you never go back to it. So you're usually not writing it very efficiently. In fact, this gentleman wrote such inefficient code that he actually took down a city website while he was scraping it. Another good reason to open the data. But the lesson here is that we need to have good, effective feedback loops for citizens. We need more open data. We know that people want data. And the reason that they want this data is because the tools to use it and to visualize it and to build things with it have never been more ubiquitous. They have never been as ubiquitous and as cheap as they are today. That is driving the demand for data. And as governments, we have got to consider how we become data stewards, how we provide data to people that want it and need it to do things in their community. And if we don't do that, if we don't give people a reasonable way to engage, and provide input on the quality of service, and we don't give people the data they want so that they can feel like they're a part of the solution to these service delivery problems, then we're going to run into all sorts of problems. And there's really not much we can do with that. So what else do we need? You've all seen these, I'm sure. This is an example from the city of New York. This is their Adopt a Highway program. And if you are a business or an organization that wants to volunteer take care of a section of the New York City highway, you get your name here, and they put your name up in public. You get official sanction from the City of New York. This is an official sanction if you get to put your name on a signpost on the side of a road in New York City. But we need official sanction for the stuff that we're doing. Now, I know that the civic hacking community is very strong in this state, and there are many elected officials that are connected to that. We see this happen a lot in different parts of the Philadelphia, and New York, and Chicago, and San Francisco. We see public officials and elected officials coming to these events and being a part of this community. But are they doing it because they are also interested members of the community, or is it an official part of their job? It's hard to say. It's a little bit ambiguous. Here's an example from the City of Philadelphia. City of Philadelphia has a program called the Block Captains Program. You can become a block captain if you are an interested member of your community and you get enough of your neighbors to actually sign a petition, I think it is, and you give it to the city parks department, you become a block captain. Your responsibility is conferred upon you. And in fact, in the city of Philadelphia, you get a block captain ID. You get an ID that says you're a block captain. You get a rule book. You get all sorts of materials. You get a liaison, I think, with the city that you can talk to. This is official sanction. This is the city officially conferring responsibility on essentially a volunteer. And I think that that's important. Again, remember this long tradition of volunteerism in this country and what it means and how important it is. When we think about volunteers like volunteer firefighters, they have official capacity. They are given money. They are given resources. They are given position. And that is a critical part of what they do. And I believe that that same thing needs to happen with the civic hacking community. We need official sanction from the governments that we're working with. So let's just wrap up our review of the present thusly. We now know there's a long tradition of volunteerism and collaboration, of which civic hacking is a part. There is a decades-old body of academic study that you can go read about on co-production if you have trouble sitting in medical school. Most definitely help you in that regard. There has been a very wide proliferation of tools for building digital services and using data. I can't emphasize that enough. There has never been as much raw material out there for building things as there is today. And I could say the same thing tomorrow and it would be true. And you know, North Carolina is a great example of this, but civic hacking spread from coast to coast. It's spread from border to border in this state. It's pretty impressive. I think the important thing to sort of consider when we talk about what the future might look like and why we're maybe in sort of a special point here is this. When I mentioned the foundation of dissatisfaction in the government, that's probably always existed, right? As long as government has existed, there has existed dissatisfaction with the job of government on the part of those being served. Here's what's different about where we are right now. It has never, ever before been possible for people to design their own interaction with government. It has never been possible to do that before. It has never been possible for people to design their own way of consuming information and data from government, and that is possible today. And it's becoming more possible with each passing day. So what does the future look like? Again, I don't know what the future looks like, but here's some thoughts on where we might go. Now I'm introducing a concept from the platform GitHub. Anybody ever heard of this, the pull request hack? Okay, there's gonna be a session this afternoon on GitHub. Somebody's making a pitch on that, so if you wanna learn a little bit more about GitHub, definitely check that out. The pitch will be coming up in just a little bit. But the way GitHub works is, if I maintain an open source software project, somebody can actually suggest an enhancement by sending me what's called a pull request. They're saying, pull my changes into your changes and make them part of the thing that you're taking care of. On GitHub, that's called a pull request. So this is an idea that I read about not long ago, and I thought it was really interesting. It comes from somebody who is maintaining a lot of open source projects, and was basically running out of time. He said, I can't take care of this project the way I want to in the past. And one day, somebody sent him a pull request, and he said, you know what I'm going to do? You send me a pull request. I'm going to turn it around, and I'm going to give you commit access to this. I'm going to say, you're interested in this? You want to send me an enhancement or a suggestion for improvement? You now have the ability to submit that request yourself. You can merge that all on your own if you want. And the person that submitted the pull request was a little bit taken back and said, whoa, all right, I didn't realize you were going there. And it turns out that person became more involved and ended up becoming one of the stewards of this open source project. And I thought, this is interesting. What if we could do this with civic problems? What if we could do this when somebody makes a complaint to a city or a county or a government? And the government turned around and said, that's a great idea. How would you like to be a part of the solution? How would you like to help fix that? Wouldn't that be an interesting response from government? Well, here's why the pull request hack works. And if this is going to work for civic problems, we need to think about this. GitHub offers a really simple way to submit requests for changes. It's actually built into the platform. It's one of the core things you do on GitHub. There are easy ways for the maintainer of that project to evaluate the usefulness of the suggestion and also the skill of the requester. So if we think about this in terms of like a public meeting, is this just somebody coming up to the microphone and yelling? Or is this somebody making a thoughtful suggestion? I think that's kind of an interesting question that we need to ask. There's also an easy way to grant control and responsibility. All of these things are built into GitHub. So if we're going to do this for civic problems, we need to start thinking about whether or not these tools exist in our current infrastructure for civic discourse and civic dialogue. Do we have an easy way for people to submit requests for changes? Do we have an easy way for the people in government to evaluate the usefulness of the suggestion and the skill of the requester? Is this something that I really want? helping me solve this problem? Do we have easy ways to grant control and responsibility to people so they can help us fix things? We're going to do this, and these are the things we need to consider. Bob Mueller was talking yesterday, and he mentioned this concept of vending machine government, right? So this idea that people are used to just putting their money in the vending machine and getting out, you know, the service that they get for their tax money. And this notion sort of flips that on its head, right? So this isn't just somebody at a public meeting yelling and complaining and saying why they don't like things. This is the people behind the panel standing up and saying, we want to serve that, we want you to help us. Now, what kind of government does that person want? Do they want vending machine government, or they simply say, no, I came to this meeting to tell you what was wrong so that you could fix it? Or do we have people who are standing up and saying, I want to be a part of that solution? I think it's the latter, but we need to do these things if we're going to affect that kind of change. Here's another idea. This is an idea that came out of at the very end of the Bloomberg administration in New York City. He actually created this thing he called Code Core. And this was going to be a group of professional data scientist types that were going to actually help the city use its data in smarter ways. It happened, I think, after Hurricane Sandy hit New York. And there was a lot of mobilization of volunteers, both data scientists and tech people, and also other volunteers to help address the problem. And this idea really struck me as important because it was one of the only examples I could find where a government was giving official sanction to a group of civic hackers, basically saying, you're going to be official, we're going to confer official status on you, you're actually going to help us do things smarter. Unfortunately, it went away in the de Blasio administration. It didn't carry over. But I thought it was really inspiring and encouraging to sort of see this, where you have the biggest municipal government in the country basically saying, if we're going to do this right, we need smart people that aren't inside government. You guys are part of the answer as well, and we need you. I think here's where we are. I don't know what the future looks like, but I do think it's time for new models and new ideas for working together. I think a lot of the tools we have in our civic toolbox are very, very heavily influenced by Silicon Valley and by startup culture. And I don't think that's a bad thing. I think that's a good thing. You know, we talk about, anybody here ever heard of ATF or the USDS and Office of New Urban Mechanics? There was one in Philadelphia, there was one in Boston. So this idea of creating startups inside government, I think that's really useful to a certain extent. But I wonder if we've reached the point where we can't learn anything more from the model of Silicon Valley and applying that to government. We need new ideas, we need new models for collaborating with people. And certainly Silicon Valley does not have a monopoly on those ideas. Is the pull request hack a way that we can collaborate differently? I like it. I don't know if it'll work, but I'm not afraid to put it out there. I encourage all of you to think about ways that we can collaborate together to make our communities better, because I really think we started something here. I'm not really sure where it's going. I'm less interested now in talking about what the future looks like, and I'm more interested in coming to events like this and working with all of you to actually help build the future. So thank you very much.